Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. My name is Al-Ghamdi Rauf from room 86, number 36. Today, I'm going to tell you the climax of the first and second part of the German epic Nibelungenlied. But first, I'm going to tell you the brief summary of the first part of the epic. The Nibelungenlied combines two stories. Each of long-standing in Germanic tradition, the character of the Burgundian princess Grimhild is used to link them. In the first half, she is betrothed to the heroic Siegfried, a prince from the Rhineland who comes to the Burgundian royal palace at Worms. His past exploits have brought him a great treasure, the gold of a Nibelungs and the magic clock which enables him to become invisible. He uses this ability combined with his own athletic prowess to help Grimhild's brother, Gunther, the king of Burgundy, in a rather unusual courtship. News comes of a distant queen who will only marry a hero who can match her own prowess in hurling a spear, throwing a stone, and jumping. Gunther wishes to marry her but is no match for this Nordic Amazon. So Siegfried performs his necessary feat using his trick of invisibility to make Gunther seem the athletic hero. Brunhild accepts Gunther as her husband. After the double marriage has taken place, the deception is discovered by Brunhild, a follower of Gunther's, the evil Hagen, uses the occasion to murder Siegfried, presenting it as an act of vengeance. Siegfried is given a magnificent funeral. Hagen, to prevent Grimhild receiving Siegfried's treasure, sinks the gold in the Rhine. The climax of the first part of the epic is when Brunhild owes a reprisal or revenge with Hagen. Hagen is the most honest and devoted vassal or a companion of Gunther, and she plans to kill Siegfried. Gunther pretends that enemies are about to attack Burgundy and announces that there is an upcoming war which is literally fake. Siegfried volunteers to stop them or to defend it. Hagen, pretending to be worried about the negligent courage of Siegfried, and she suddenly convinces Grimhild to reveal to him the weak spot on Siegfried's body, which is his shoulder. The vacillating Hagen promises to protect this spot, which is his shoulder, from the enemy. The enemy's attack? Of course, it does not happen, and the royal party goes to hunting. After the hunt, when all are exhausted, Siegfried was very thirsty and goes to stream to drink. As he bends over the water, Hagen finally managed to kill Siegfried on his weak spot, his vulnerable shoulder, using his spear because of deceiving Grimhild, telling her that he'll protect her husband. And that climax is the end of the first part of the epic. The second half of the poem, in which Brunhild plays no further part, concentrates on another process of retaliation, Grimhild's attempts to avenge the murder of her husband Siegfried. She achieves this by getting her brothers and Hagen invited to the court of Itzel, king of the Huns. Away from the safety of Burgundy, the brothers are killed. Grimhild herself slays a captive Hagen when he refuses to tell her the whereabouts of Siegfried's treasure, after which she, the last of the Burgundians, is herself slain. The climax of the second part of the epic is a complicated and bewildering series of events relating the atrocious and horrifying revenge of Grimhild on those who killed her husband. To secure her revenge, she marries Itzel, the king of Huns, and invites all the kinsmen, including Hagen, to a great feast. Grimhild involves them in a bloody battle in which thousands are slain. Gunther and Hagen are taken prisoners and put to death by Grimhild, who herself is killed at the end of the epic.